Good morning again. Let's get into the papers on of the press this morning. The Punch newspaper has this as its headline. Federal government releases fresh debtors list. November. 77 oil firms owe 2.66 trillion naira. Firms fail to remit petroleum profit tax, income tax, education tax, VAT, others. We're partnering EFCC, NFRU to recover 2.66 trillion naira from oil firms, says agency. Also, Nexim votes 36 billion naira for SMEs export business in 36 states. Northern governors under fire over silence as Kaduna death toll hits 51. Also, this one says, petrol landing costs now 278 naira, says Moman. Crude reaches $80. Vaccination. Senate to probe maltreatment of Nigerian travelers in Ghana. Only Lagos, Rivers, and Anambra can survive on IGR, VAT, and that's according to reports. Also on the Punch newspaper, jailed Invictus Obi says, it's an insult to compare him to Hush Puppy. Develop undersea ports, decongest Apapa gridlock, Akeredolu tells federal government. Saraki, Bimisola, Taku Kwara government over demolition of local government library. Police comb waterways, others to free abducted retired general in Lagos. Shiite clash with soldiers, police in Abuja, allege 8 members killed. Restructuring. Only solution must be done before 2023, Afeniferi insist.
And on to the Daily Independent newspapers. Big one there says 77 oil firms, all federal government, 2.6 trillion naira as it borrows for budget deficit. Also, Shiites and police disagree on death of 8 IMN members after clash. Reps probe NYSC call on call members to prepare ransom before leaving home. And also, Secundus no longer an issue. PDP insists to meet with Jonathan. IPOB and other separatist agitators to join October 1st, seat at home. Or rather, IPOB asks other separatist agitators to join October 1st, seat at home. Oil prices rise above $80 per barrel for the first time in 3 years. Senate moves to repeal the Electricity Power Sector Reform Act. And also, 2023 presidency, don't set nation on fire. Northern youths warn southern and northern governors. Middle Belt Forum blasts northern governors for opposing power rotation. A northern governor's position violates the constitution, says Adegburua. Supreme Court, Okowa mourn Justice Oseji. And of course, here in Lagos, Governor Sanwo-Olu says attackers of security agencies will face justice. Those are the stories on the Daily Independent.
Let's turn to the leadership newspaper, Power Shifts. Northern governors divided over Kaduna declaration. Middle Belt youths disown northern governors, traditional rulers. Resolution portends bleak future. Nigeria collapsing under northern leadership. That's according to Ohanaeze. And the EFC fires back, says they're Sikh. Also on the leadership, oil production. Nigeria struggling to meet 1.7 million barrels per day OPEC quota. President Muhammadu Buhari approves 159 new radio and TV stations. Amid defection rumor, PDP invites Jonathan to convention. Supreme Court loses second justice in 6 months. Security agents are informants to criminals. That's according to the CG of the NSCDC. Senate reps in supremacy battle over bills conference. 6 killed as Shiites clash with army and police in Abuja. Those are the stories on the leadership newspaper.
And on The Guardian, 77 oil firms owe Nigeria $6.48 billion amid continuous borrowing. Nigeria's debt may hit 40 trillion naira by 2022. And it says also outstanding tax enough to offset budget deficit, says ex-CITN boss. Still on The Guardian, World Heart Day, experts warn on spike in heart disease, cases, and deaths. And Anambra LP gubernatorial candidates' whereabouts unknown. Still on The Guardian this morning, Ohanaeze tasks northern leaders on unity, Nigeria's survival. Afeniferi chides northern governors back southerners on power shift VAT collection. Again, headers kill 9 in Autumn's local government. Lead mine collapses on 3. Lead mine, I beg your pardon. Senate directs local multinational oil gas firms to relocate to operational bases. And I think finally here, editors urge governors to emulate Bello on media empowerment. Those are the major stories that we can find on the papers this morning. Good morning to Mr. Ademola Akinbola, publisher of the Podium Media. Thanks for joining us.
Morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning. Nice to be here again.
Yeah, I think we can start with the Shiites and the security agencies issue in Abuja that has reportedly led to the loss of another 8 lives. I'm not sure if you've seen any clips and feedback from that.
These things don't seem to suppress or shock us any longer these days. I mean, it's going to a stage where we all we do is just resign to fate, and we just count the number of casualties. Okay, because almost every week there's something going on, killing Zamfara, Kaduna, the whole of the northern part of the country is just under siege, and it's just unfortunate. And what I don't understand is, why hasn't the governments of these states declared a state of emergency, Kaduna especially? Okay? The same El-Rufai, as all of this is happening under his nose, asked them to poke nose into what is going on in the south, asked them to play politics with people's lives, and all of this is going on, and you haven't thought it fit to declare a state of emergency, get the soldiers onto the street, to restore normalcy, to ensure that lives are safe. So for me, even before the end of this program, we may hear of another attack. So it's like we are just used to it. I mean, it shouldn't be, but we are used to it. And it just shows that truly the federal government, the state government, they've lost control of the security situation in the country. I don't think we need to look further.
Aside the Kaduna issue, I think the story is mostly referring to a protest or a walk yesterday by Shiites in Abuja that eventually, of course, led to loss of lives again when the police and the army attacked these protesters reportedly fired live rounds at them. There's also reports that they took some of the bodies away. There's also a video clip that was posted by Omoyele Sowore that showed some army members beating up the Shiite members. Okay.
Then you want to look at the underlying issues. How did we get to a state where the Shiites have become so powerful? Remember, 2 or 3 years ago, there was a bloody clash. Their leader was arrested and jailed, and it's like they are back more powerfully. And if you just look at it, Kaduna State is not big. How come it's so difficult for the government to govern? Kaduna is not a big state, really. It's not as big as Kaduna. It just shows that the volatility in Kaduna State, it's a sequel to probably poor governance, or that the fact that the governor has distanced himself from the people. So something needs to be done. Kaduna wasn't like this before. Yet it's only been a hotbed of radicalism and political controversies, but it's never been bad like this. Kaduna, Ibadan, Enugu used to be the regional hotbeds. But Kaduna in recent times seems to have really, things have gone haywire. So for me, I think the federal government should declare a state of emergency in Kaduna State, and let's see how this will work over the next few months. Yeah.
Okay, so across the papers this morning, what's made headlines is the fact that 77 oil firms currently owe the federal government the sum of 2.6 trillion naira. Yeah. So when we look at how it's stated on the Punch newspaper, it went on to explain that these states are owing the federal government as much as 2.66 trillion naira because they failed to remit petroleum profit tax, education tax, VAT, and others. What do you say to this? Are we having challenges with how we collect these taxes?
The first question you want to ask is, how did it happen? How did it happen? How did we get to a stage where so much is being owed? Okay? Then you want to call into question the efficiency of FIRS, the efficiency of the state internal revenue services also. And it shows that there's a high level of collusion and conspiracy going on between officials of this revenue collection agencies and state government. It's something that we know. even in the private sector, in Lagos, if you receive a charge or an invoice from LIRS, you can negotiate it. A portion of it goes to the officials, a small portion goes to the government coffers. So we know these things happen. And my question is, how did we get to a state whereby so much is being owed? And also, this may support argument for fiscal federalism. Okay? Let state and local government get more involved. Okay? Let them control revenue collection. If you know that this revenue you are collecting is what you will spend, I think people will be more serious, will be more honest and transparent. But because when they collect the money, they remit it into the federal court, they don't seem happy with what comes back to them. So it's like, okay, let's sit on this money. And even for the oil firms too, we need to find out how did we get to this stage. And these are the leakages that will not allow the Nigerian economy to go forward. We're talking about almost $3 trillion naira here. Enough money to finance the budget, enough money to reduce our borrowing. Okay, and you want to ask how long will this take before this is recovered? And once the list is out, you will see litigations. All sorts of delayed taxes will be deployed by the debtors, and maybe for the next 3 years we're going to be on this. So I mean, I live in a place where you cannot even owe accommodation bill for more than a month. Electricity you can't even owe. The system detects and they just knock you off. But in Nigeria, I'm sure this is not debt that happened overnight. It has been there for over the years, accumulating. And some folks in the government must have been receiving one form of gratification or the other to suppress this. So I'm happy that this has come into the open. The next question is, how do we get this done? How do we tackle it? There will be a lot of controversies. People are going to be querying and they're going to be doubting, they're going to be disowning some of these debts. That's why I say for the next 2 or 3 years, we'll probably be on this. Mm. But something needs to be done. For me, we need to decentralize the Federal Inland Revenue Service. It's still part of the problem that the center is too powerful in Nigeria. The center is too powerful, and the constituent units are not happy because look at the vast controversy. You send so much to Abuja, and you get so little. Other states that don't even send as much as you send, they get more than you do. So that cannot hold. That's where we need to look at restructuring, and fiscal federalism will ensure that states become more committed to revenue generation because they know the money is coming back to them. They are the ones that will spend the money.
All right. Also on the Daily Independent, there's something about the October 1st celebration. It says IPOB asks other separatist groups or agitators to join October 1st sit at home. Mr. Kimola, what do you think? Do you, see any linkage between these separatist groups? Or will Nigerians maybe also buy into the idea of the IPOB sit at home to protest?
If you evaluate IPOB activities in the Southeast in the last 1 month, you will realize that the sit at home has been quite effective. I do get in touch with folks there from time to time, and there's so much confusion. It's like they give them 2 or 3 days to go to the market and all that. But IPOB has no right to ask people not to go out. I mean, that's part of the breakdown in security that we're talking about. People have the right to free movement. IPOB, any regional association has no right to ask people not to go out. So maybe you want to find out, okay, previously, how has this been complied with? And I will say, unfortunately, people do comply. People do comply because what IPOB does is to go ahead and aggressively and violently enforce this order. Okay? They get people arrested, they get people beaten up, they get people dehumanized just to ensure compliance. So the police should do something about this. They issue a statement that people should go about their normal businesses and ensure there are enough policemen on the streets to ensure that people are not molested or dehumanized. So for me, it's another sign of the fact that who owns Nigeria? Government is not in control. That's the truth. Government is not in control. Yeah. Because if IPOB is truly proscribed, then IPOB should not be issuing orders that will be this effective.
Okay. Yeah. But do you see any sense in the other separatist groups buying into that idea, not forcing people now, but looking at sitting at home as their own form of protesting, and you know, encouraging people to also do same.
Sitting at home has never worked. I said it on this program a couple of weeks ago. It hurt the economy, it hurt the people, because at the end of the day, we do not have the capacity to see it through. Nigeria is a country where we start an agitation and it just tears off with time. And you begin to wonder, what have we gained? I remember 2014, Occupy Nigeria. I was in Nigeria. I was going after the fourth day. People started bringing music. They were bringing food. And that was the end of the agitation. So sit at home has never worked. And I wouldn't expect the other groups to join, because it makes no sense, really. It's like after the fundraising, people should stay at home in Lagos and this all start with. We are going to bring the economy to its knee, and the people are the ones that will suffer. All right. The suffering is much already. So I don't think they should join. It makes no sense.
So this VAT story really has been trending for the past few weeks, and we know the origins, yeah? But the report by Budget has, you know, done its analysis and came up with a report that says that only Lagos, Rivers, and Anambra states can survive on their internally generated revenue and VAT, and that the rest of the country really would fall behind economically. So the question is, what's Lagos doing differently, and how can these other states, you know, develop prosperity in their country, in their states, regarding their finances?
Yeah, this is something that we've always known over the years, that most of the states are not viable. The states are political creations embarked upon to satisfy the desires of politicians. I mean, we know Lagos is viable today because Lagos used to be the commercial center of Nigeria. Okay, it is the commercial center. It used to combine both until IBB moved the capital to Abuja. So Lagos is viable because there are so many businesses in Lagos, and we are even saying what Lagos is collecting IGR today is even probably 10% of what Lagos should be collecting. Okay, so there are so many businesses in Lagos, and that it is so easy for Lagos to have a lot of money coming in. And the same thing with River State. Oil companies, other businesses are there. And we said, look, must we have 36 states? No. As part of restructuring, maybe we need to begin to merge states, because the states are just in a mess. Remember shortly before Buhari came in, most of the states could not pay salaries. And I think if something is not done, we may be going back to that state now. The states are not viable. There's nothing that they can do. They're not viable. Another thing we need to look at is the profile of public expenditure at these states. What they are carrying is insane. I mean, look at most of the states. They spend over 70% of what they earn. They spend it on paying civil servants. They spend it on recurrent expenditure. So they have little or nothing to spend on capital projects. They can't do anything. By the time they pay civil servants, they have little or nothing left. That was the problem that this guy had in Osun State, Anambra, when he refused to pay civil servants. Say, look, you are not the only people in the state. We need money for development purposes. And eventually it worked against him. So Lagos is very, because there are so many, there's nothing different that Lagos is doing. Lagos is just riding and leveraging on the fact that it is viable. So many people are, that too many companies are operating there, so many businesses are operating there, and there's a population.
So what can these other states do, since, you know, that merger might not be on the table at the moment?
Yes, so what the state should do is to want to plug leakages. There are leakages in all the states. Okay, there are leakages in all the states. Plug the leakages, find a way, employ more people, put policies in place to ensure that you capture. The local government should be more involved in revenue collection, because they know these people, right? Outside Lagos, they know them very well. They know the business they run. And corruption should also be reduced. We can't say exterminated, but it should be reduced. In these states where we complain that they are not viable, the money that they are making, what percentage goes to government coffers? Maybe 30%. So corruption needs to be checked. They need to put in place measures to plug leakages, okay? They need to bring everybody into the tax net. A lot of businesses are not registered and they are making money, okay? Because of the fact that we still rely so much on cash transactions in Nigeria, but there are no records. And when businesses are not registered, when they don't have bank accounts, you can't even know that they are making money or not. So we need to work with the CAC to ensure that businesses must be registered before they operate. That way, we will have records, we will be able to track their tax liabilities, and we will be able to get more people paying tax. So those are the things the other states should also do.
Okay.
All right. Some other thing that has been major discussions in the last few weeks, it's on the 2023 presidency. It says here on the Daily Independent, don't set nation on fire. Northern youths warn southern and northern governors. And also the Middle Belt Forum blasts Northern Governors Forum for opposing power rotation.
Yeah. I said last week that we don't have a nation, we don't have a country, we just have loose units coming together, calling themselves states. 2023 is going to be very interesting. What the northern leaders, the emirs, governors, they are playing a game that's going to burn their fingers and that will burn the country. Okay. Yes, the constitution does not support power rotation, but morally, that is what we should be doing. We've had 8 years of the north. It's inconceivable that the north will want to have power again in 2023. Some people say, oh, I don't care, merit, let the best. Yes, but we have good people in the South too. Okay, there's no section of the country that has a monopoly of producing good candidates. And in the interest of fairness and equity, if 8 years we are beyond that northern rule, let the South also have a shot. And that is why we need to go back to the issue of restructuring. There are too many issues, and you look at northern governors, they've opposed virtually everything. Open grazing, they opposed it. VAT, they opposed it. Power rotation, they opposed it. And you begin to wonder, are we in the same country? No country can make progress as long as there is strife among the leaders. So if the leaders, if the people that we look up to take us to the promised land, if they quarrel openly, if they issue inflammatory statements, then what do you expect the followers to do? So everybody has lost hope, lost confidence in them. And like sometimes people say, let's go back to the drawing board.
I hope
that leaders of the two political parties, reason will prevail and something sensible will be done. I do not think that we'll consider this way.
Yeah, but I want you to also speak on, one of the, riders to that story, and where it's the Middle Belt Forum saying that they're not in agreement with the Northern Elders Forum and whoever else, is creating those narratives. Why I'm asking that is because a lot of times when the North is talking about its numbers and, its control and some of all of that, it seems like they're always pulling numbers from the Middle Belt and from, all those other regions and, assume those numbers are included to theirs. How important it is for the different segments and sections in the country to be able to identify themselves and say, this is our stance and we're not in any way a part of this plan.
Yeah. Yeah. You recall that the Middle Belt has never really seen itself as part of the North. They've over the years fought this battle for recognition, for a distinct identity. So I'm not surprised that they are coming out. So the Middle Belt has become the beautiful bride. Okay, that is what they are trying to position themselves to be. They will never go with the North. Okay, and talking about the game of numbers, the Northern governors are just living in self-delusion because your numbers will not be enough at the end of the day. Remember, President Buhari contested 3 or 4 times. Relying basically on Northern vote, he didn't get it. So there will always be need for alliance between the North and the South. Reasonable, positive alliance. So I don't think any section of the country should arrogate political relevance to itself. Okay, we all need each other. The North needs the South. The South needs the North. And the Middle Belt, because of its strategic importance, will continue to be the beautiful bride. Okay, it used to be the Southeast, but the Southeast is so fragmented and so disorganized now that you don't even know where they belong. So 2023 will see the Middle Belt imagine as a force to reckon with, because over the years they've been able to achieve a distinct identity. And don't forget that the killings in Benue State, all of this will come into play. Okay, these are factors that will determine the direction that the Middle Belt will go in 2023. That's the way I look at it.
All right. So since we're talking about 2023, let's look at something that's on the Daily Independent newspaper. And it says that Secunda's no longer an issue. PDP insists to meet with Jonathan. I also see that earlier on the Punch newspaper. It says that amid defection rumors that the PDP has invited Jonathan to their convention. Let's take a look at the issue with Jonathan and the PDP, because we know how much of a role he's played in the international community, you know, ever since his tenure as president, and how it seems that there seems to be a clamor for him to come back and run for 2023. Do you see that likelihood happening in the next few months?
For me, it's shameful. It's shameful that PDP, after 8 years, is holding on to Jonathan as one of its viable options, because this is the same man that practically ran the country at Grant. Although today people say, oh, things were better under Jonathan than what they are today, but under Jonathan, they haven't done very well. So for me, PDP would be how do I put it? PDP would not appear to be a serious political party if Jonathan is the one they're touting to be their number one candidate. And I just think that this kite flying will not work. It's not something we should dissipate too much time. And I don't even see Jonathan winning the party's ticket. I really don't see him winning the ticket. You realize that he came into government, I want to say by default, following the death of Yar'Adua. And of course, he used the power of incumbency to win the election. I do not think Dr. Jonathan is a good man, gentleman. I don't think he has the political clout to win the president to win the presidency for the PDP. He'll make a big mistake. It's not a candidate the PDP should be looking at now. Personally, I don't think
go,
so. Yeah.
Go on and share your thoughts on the possibility of him defecting, even, you know, and what, you know, how this, you know, would hit the PDP or the APC or the Nigerian people.
One, nothing is impossible when it comes to politics in Nigeria. But quite frankly, Dr. Jonathan is not a political asset that any of the party should jostle to have. I mean, that's my opinion. He's not, I mean, he just like Faneca or the joint APC, what's going to be the impact? He can't even win an election in front of his house. So there are some political paperweights that you don't even want to waste time on. And unfortunately, Dr. Jonathan, his profile as ex-president is what everybody is looking at. But we need to look at the viability of candidature as a president. He's not going to fly. So it won't fly. Oh. It won't.
Will it also matter if he's not being used as a candidate, but simply defecting, you know, and how much damage would that do to the, you know, stance that the PDP currently has, and also to his own political future?
Little or no damage. Dr. Jonathan leaving the PDP would except the PDP is not really serious and they are not structured or organized for the 2023 election. Let me tell you, the next election is for the PDP to lose. If they put their house in order, they have everything going for them. It will just be the way it was in 2015. 2015, Nigerians wanted anybody except Jonathan. They wanted anybody except PDP. And say the way the country is now, Nigerians want any party except APC. So the PDP needs to look beyond Jonathan. The PDP needs to organize itself and begin a massive mobilization campaign. People want a change. People want a change. And the APC, the change the APC has brought is a negative change. So people want a change. And since there are two viable political parties, Nigerians don't mind going back to PDP, but it depends on which candidate. So Jonathan leaving the PDP would not cause any damage. Jonathan joining the APC, I don't see the value is going to have beyond the hype in the media. Yeah.
All right.
Politically now, it's not going to have much.
Okay. So, on the front page of the Punch newspaper, there's a story that says that the NEXIM votes 36 billion naira for SMEs export business in 36 states. So basically, the Nigerian Export-Import Bank has gone on to say that it has voted a minimum of 1 billion naira for SMEs in each state of Nigeria. This is good news, definitely, especially those who are in the export business. But let's look at at, you know, where we're coming from regarding how these monies are disbursed. You know, there's always that concern, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
About if the money would finally go to the people it's intended for, that's the businesses that, you know, export.
Yeah. I mean, I always like to adopt a realistic approach to issues in Nigeria. This money has been voted on paper. The money is there. But in reality, who can confidently say the money will go to the right places? Just like the way it works in the banks, the CBN comes out to say, oh, we've spent so much money on agri development, we've given farmers. Which farmers are you giving the money to? The same way commercial bank will say, oh, we've advanced credit worth XYZ to the SMEs. And yet, the economy is not growing. So where is the money going to? The money is going to the hands of importers. Importers who put so much pressure on our foreign exchange. And that's where the problem is. Monitoring is a big problem in the public sector in Nigeria. Nobody monitors anything. Nobody. So Nexim on paper is doing well. The amount voted sounds good. It's a tidy sum. But let them go a step further to ensure that this money gets to the right hands. Again, how do we register and monitor SMEs in Nigeria? We don't keep records. We don't keep records. Okay? I do not know if the CBN SME department has accurate records of viable SMEs in this country. A lot of businesses are registered on paper simply because people want to take advantage of funds like this, not because they really want to do anything. So we need to be very tight with our monitoring. We need to be very tight with the registration of SMEs. Viability is key. People must file tax returns. If you register a business here, you have to file your tax returns. If you don't make any money, you still have to file a return. In Nigeria, this doesn't happen. So good on paper. My concern is how do we ensure that this money is used for the purpose for which it is intended?
All right. Let's move over. Well, still on the Daily Independent, apparently there's a lot of stories that we haven't touched yet. There's one here that I would call a little hilarious, and it says the reps probe NYSE's call on call members to prepare ransom before leaving home. This made headlines sometime last week, where, of course, parts of the NYSE booklet, there was, you know, some places that were stated that, you know, you may want to prepare your own ransom. And if you are kidnapped, you know, build a relationship with your kidnappers, ask them their hobbies, you know, and you know, be friends. So, quickly speak on.
Was this statement not denied by the NYSE?
Well, that's why denied. That's why the Senate is investigating, you know, the matter.
If the NYSE has already denied, what are you investigating? That means you are jobless. There are better things to investigate. Okay, if it was something that was issued in the mainstream media, and that's why we have to be very careful with the social media. And I do not expect the reps to take everything they read in the social media as the gospel truth. There is no way the NYSE will issue such a statement. It's not possible.
Necessarily that put out a statement like that. I think it's, you know, people that were taking screenshots from the booklet, the NYSE booklet that was given to them.
Yeah, but the NYSE has the responsibility to either confirm
deny. It is, Mr. Kimball, it's actually confirmed that it is in the NYSE handbook.
It's in the NYSE handbook?
Yes.
Yes.
It was added to the NYSE handbook.
That's so unfortunate. And whoever is responsible should be sanctioned. So maybe the House of Reps is right after all to investigate it. Maybe that caution should have been couched in a better way, really. But not to say prepare to pay ransom. You could have said something like, please stay safe, avoid going to places alone and stuff like that. And it calls to question the level of supervision that public officers do have. Someone in the public relations department should have seen that brochure booklet before it was printed, line by line editing and all that. So it's a shame, actually, if it was established that it's contained in the booklet. And whoever is found to be responsible should actually be punished. Yeah. But the statement, as bad as it is the truth. Yeah. That's the unfortunate thing. It's the truth. Nigerian
that's where I was going to, you know. So isn't this a good time to now have conversations on NYC postings to certain areas in the country, and maybe also a suspension of the scheme for a year until we can figure out security?
Absolutely. I have, even prior to now, I've always advocated a scrapping of the scheme or reduction to just 3 months. The NYSA, as it was originally structured and intended, has lost its relevance. It's just a waste of time. Keep people there for 1 year, they come back, nothing has been gained, really. So let us ensure that students served in their state of origin. They should start in the state where they have gone to school. That's not what is the adventure about. There's no fun again.
Mr. Akimola, lots of people would disagree with you, people like myself, to be honest, who I would definitely say that in my career journey, my posting to Adamawa State was really the nudge that, you know, threw me into television journalism. I had been in radio all along.
So how many years ago?
This was in 2017, in the height of the Boko Haram insurgency in Adamawa State. I mean, bombs were going off in Adamawa State, and people would call me to say, "Are you safe?" No, well, that's what I'm saying, that yes, times seem to have changed, right? So we can advocate for people who, like me, who benefited from the scheme, right? It's definitely is not the same for everybody. We could maybe say, let's suspend this till we have our security on check, right? But to say that the scheme should be totally scrapped or for people to be posted to their states, I don't really know much about that, really.
Let me tell you, if you ask parents in Nigeria today, do you want your son or daughter to go for NYSC in the north? 95% will tell you no. They will tell you, at the end of the day, what is the benefit? NYSC in those days was an avenue for you to know the country, to learn, to get exposed. These days, is it the same experience? No, it's not. It's not. In those days, you will be gainfully employed as an NYSC member. Everybody was busy. These days, they don't do anything. They get posted to companies, they are rejected from day one. So for the 12 months, these poor guys, they roam the street doing nothing. So we need to have a conversation around the continued relevance of NYSC in Nigeria. It's not enough to have it simply because we also have it. Let's reduce it to 3 months, 3 to 6 months of intensive vocational skills acquisition. The skills that these guys will need to survive in life. What's the point in going for NYSC for 12 months? You come back, you can't get a job. So that period that you've gone, can we convert it to a period of knowledge acquisition for them? Equip them with the skills, life skills, skills that they will use to survive. Skills that will not make them to be liabilities onto their families. That is my view. You don't run the program simply because it's nice to do. No, beyond the security challenge that we are going through next year, the NYSC scheme is not adding any value. That is my argument, and I'm ready to advance this argument anyway. Most parents don't even want their kids to go. Do you know the amount of corruption that takes place in NYSC today? As people manipulate the posting, everybody wants to stay in Lagos, Abuja. So the purpose has been defeated. Most people, they school in those states, they end up serving in those states. They school in Lagos, they end up serving in Lagos. So the idea, as espoused by the founding fathers, has been defeated. That's my point.
Okay.
And we spend so much money on it. What is Nigeria gaining from NYSC? What are the students gaining from NYSC? Maybe we should have a live debate and sample the opinion of parents and the students, because they are the ones that are directly involved here. Right. Okay, so we need to incorporate their views. You went because your case was just maybe an isolated case of, oh, you went, you had a nice time. A lot of people have very torrid experience of NYSC. These are people that will stay at home for 3-4 months waiting for batch B, batch C, or whatever nonsense batch. 3 months wasted at home, then another 12 months. Then they come and there's no job. Almost 18 months wasted in the life of a human being. It can only happen in Nigeria. We're wasting people's time too much. So for me, shortening to a 3-month intensive program, what of all the military training that they are going through in camp, is kidnapping, not pressing every day. Let's train them survival skills in a competitive environment. Give them intensive 3 months, 6 months training program, and give them certificates that employers of labor will recognize all over the world. That is the direction I think we should go in, really, with NYSC.
I agree. Okay. All right. Let's still talk in security. The NSCDC, CG here, says security agents are informants to criminals. You know, it might be a little indicting here, but, you know, share your thoughts quickly.
Are you surprised? Asaro, are you surprised? It has always been with us. It's always been with us. As far back as the days of Anene, remember, in Edo State, a top police officer, I can't remember his name now, was the informant. It's always been like that. It's always been like that. And because corruption has taken over the entire fabric of Nigerian nation, you cannot even rule it out any longer. In those days, we used to have isolated cases, a police officer supplying armed robbers with ammunition. But today, it's big business. Because the average policeman claims to be hungry, claims to be underpaid, okay? No insurance, no welfare. The police barracks are not well kept. The children are not happy. So tell me, why it won't take the grace of God for an average security officer not to collude with criminals? They would do it willingly. So I'm not surprised, because it's a chain reaction in Nigeria. You look at the way things are, right from the way the students go to school, they pay through, they pay lecturers, okay, to pass exams, they pay to get posted to choice states. They get to NYSC camp, they pay, they stay in Lagos, and they are serving in Edo State on paper, but he or she is in Lagos. When he finishes school, he pays to get employment. In Abuja, in some federal agencies, people pay as much as 1.5 million. I don't know if you've heard. So all around us, we are edged by corruption. So the policeman is also a member of Nigerian society. He's not an exception. The security forces, they are not insulated from corruption. So I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised at all. This has been happening over the years, but maybe more and more it's coming to the open. The security forces have always been conniving and colluding with criminals in Nigeria. It's always been happening. Long before now.
We've had other experts on the show who says this really just shows a lack of patriotism. And that these guys just get into this force because, you know, they were unemployed. I was speaking to a policeman just yesterday who was just telling me the history of how he got into the police. That he was just at home and his uncle called him to say, do you want to work in the police force?
Yeah.
This man told me, he said, okay, well, how that happened? We were just having a conversation and you know, these new recruits passed by. And he said, this guy's driving or walking past and doing their match. Now, did you see the police call for any recruitment? That no. Now, that's how it happened for him. His uncle simply called him to say, do you want to work in the police force? He never did any exam, never did anything. They just posted him to Bauchi or one of those states. He did his training for 6 or 12 months and he was redeployed to Lagos. So really, we see things like this where it's not because you're passionate about serving Nigeria. It's not because you want to eradicate crime or, you know, just serve. It's simply because it's an employment scheme. And why do we keep having this? Corruption in recruitment, in law enforcement agencies.
Exactly. In addition to that, when you talk about patriotism is a relative term. It's a relative term. What amounts of patriotism to you may not amount to patriotism to somebody else. Patriotism only happens where government has fulfilled its own side. Agreed, no country is ever able to satisfy people 100%. But to a reasonable extent, any government must take care of citizens before you talk about patriotism. Otherwise, you are just gonna be mouthing it. Okay? Nigeria is a country where people don't even understand the meaning and the spirit behind the words of the national anthem and the national pledge. In other countries, it's not like that. Okay? Because people don't care. So you go into the police force, it's an employment platform. You've been home for years. You are not going because you have passion for the country. So you are not going to put your life on the line for anybody. at the drop of the hat, you want to make money out of every situation. And that's the unfortunate thing. So if it was to be in a country where, oh, when you join the police force, you know that you are made for life. Your family will never suffer. In America, when you join the army, 6 months, you become a citizen. Something that takes other people 4 or 5 years. Okay, so they make everything so easy for you, but the screening is rigorous. The background checks is super. The character checks is on top. So that way you reduce the number of undesirable elements that find their way into the armed forces. It's not happening in Nigeria. It's not happening. That's why you find a lot of police officers, even the way they dress, you know, this one used to be an agbero. It used to be a tout. It's just so unfortunate. So, yes, the recruitment procedure needs to be looked into so that we make sure that we only get people who are passionate about serving the country. And two, the welfare needs to be looked into. We can't shout enough of the need for us to take care of. Look, the other day, Aminu Masari was saying, oh, bandits have outnumbered, what do you call it, security personnel. That is not true. What he meant to say is that bandits are more passionate about their own business than the security people. Mm. Okay? Yeah, that's the truth. Because if there's a gunshot now, there's a likelihood that the policemen will be the first to disappear. They'll be the first to run away. So it's all about passion, it's all about commitment, it's all about patriotism, which is not happening in Nigeria at all levels. At all levels.
Okay. Now let's move on, talk a little bit about the economy. You know, there's reports of oil prices hitting $80 a barrel. It says it's the first time it's happened in, you know, since the current administration has gone into power. Is this something that we should celebrate? And does this also spell, or you know, better, you know, figures for our economy, and of course for our budget?
Yeah, it's something worth celebrating as long as we do not get carried away, because it's not voodoo yet. Oil price at $80. OPEC has said oil will remain a major force of energy since 2045. So yes, we can, but that doesn't mean that we should keep relying on it. Okay, even if it gets to $120, look at the budget shortfall. Look at the deficit that we've got. Look at the borrowing profile. Look at the amount of debt that we have to pay. So good news is gone up, but we should continue to be moderate. We should continue to ensure that there's tight rein on public spending. And that's an area that we haven't really harped on. The public spending is too huge. We spent the American presidential system that we're copying is too expensive for us. We can't cope. We cannot maintain it. Okay? So yes, I'm happy oil price is going up. At the same time, our spending must go down. There are two ways to make profit in life when you're doing business. It's either you make more money or you reduce your expenses. Mm-hmm. So as a country, we can make more money and also reduce our expenses. Oil price going to $80 is not a license for us to continue to spend recklessly. We do spend recklessly in Nigeria. If we manage the little we have, we shouldn't be in this mess. Even if oil price is $50, my brother, if we manage it very well, we will not be in this mess. Yeah. So it's good for the price to go up, but more importantly, we need to put a lid on our public spending. We're wasting too much money in Nigeria. Mm. Too much.
On the lower left corner of the Daily Independent newspaper, there's a story here that says Senate moves to repeal Electricity Power Reform Sector Act. So basically, they're saying that they're taking steps to basically improve the electric power supply in Nigeria. And this, you know, bill to repeal this 2005 Electricity Reform Act scaled second reading at yesterday's plenary. And they say the bill tries to do so many things. Number one, to consolidate all legislations about the power sector into one power electricity statute, to also include renewable energy into it. So the question I really want to ask you is, would you say what we're lacking is laws in Nigeria regarding power, education, this and that? Or it's about the implementation?
Mm. Both. At the level of preparing the laws, we place personal interest over national interest. If you look at the Power Act, the unbundling of NEPA is a huge national disgrace. The way it was done, it's shameful. So in Nigeria, people make laws to satisfy their own personal interest. Okay? All over the world, yes, companies do lobby to ensure favorable laws, but not to the point that a whole nation is brought down to its knees because of the interest of a few people. Look at what happened with Bikorny, with Lagos Ibadan Expressway. Government officials, they go into some silly agreement that you wonder how was this able, how did this happen? So it's good that the bill has passed second reading, and I'm praying that it will go the old org to become a law, to be assented by the president. We need to review the entire law and guide the operation of the power sector. It's a whole lot of mess deliberately put in place to satisfy the desires of those who bought NEPA, the desires of those who control the business of power generation in Nigeria. So yes, formulation of law, there are too many loopholes. The implementation also has always been a problem with us. All over the world, a friend was telling me, said, look, we also like to drive through red lights. We do not like to stop at traffic light junctions. But when you think of the implication of being caught, then you won't do it. So it is the consequences of people's actions that we need to look at in Nigeria. People get away with too much breach of the law and nothing happens simply because you know someone who knows someone who knows someone. But the system needs to put in place whereby when you breach the law, you get punished, you get sanctioned, and it will serve as a deterrent to other people. So at two levels, while the law is being formulated, we do look at the Petroleum Industry Act that we're talking about. Okay? The president has sent it back for amendment. And you wonder, it took us over 19 years to put this together, and this is the best that we can come up with. So at the level of formulating the laws, we do not do due diligence deliberately so. We deliberately overlook a lot of things that will benefit the country. Rather, we make the laws, we make it so loose that there will be so many escape routes, there will be so many loopholes for operators to exploit. Mm-hmm. Look at even the telecom sector, the same thing. Why has NCC become so ineffective? Because the laws are so loose that MTN can afford to go to court to challenge NCC. Okay? So the power sector, we need a new set of laws that will put power in the hands of the people. Okay? You pay for electricity, you don't get service, you should get some refund, you should get some form of consolidation. But it's not happening. It is a seller's market, so that needs to change, quite frankly. So yes, I hope the rest will go to the whole org, get to the Senate, and we should be able to have a new law that will clearly spell out the deliverables on the part of the operators, that will clearly spell out exactly what we should be expecting from them, and that will clearly define sanctions. Okay, operators should face sanctions when they breach the terms of their contracts. Thank you.
All right. Ademola Akinbola, thank you so much for your time, as
thank
always,
you.
On Wednesday mornings. And we wish you a very beautiful day ahead. Looking forward to speaking
and
with you again.
And you too. And please don't forget, Aneto, don't forget to take care of the matter. Thank you.
We'll think about it. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.